said you can't talk to Hamas. They talked to get this ceasefire. You don't talk for peace by talking to chums. You talk to the most bitter enemies. Lots of us in this room have got roots in Ireland, and we know that the most intractable of conflicts ultimately led to the Friday Agreement. But the talks that come out of any ceasefire have got to be root and branch. Otherwise, the violence erupts again and again. You destroy or damage half the buildings in this crowded sliver of land if you're really trying to carry out a surgical operation. Do you tell people to move south for their safety, then bomb the south of the Strip? Is this not more reminiscent of a set nap-bar, a collective punishment of an enforced displacement of the population? Soon understand that eagerly quote Hamas leaders' inflammatory words, but they're silent about Netanyahu's Amalek speech and Israeli ministers' call for the nuclear of Gaza or other Israeli leaders' responses to eliminate Gaza once they turn it into a condo on the beach. We have to look at violence on both sides, because any resolution has to address violence on both sides. History didn't start on October the 7th. There is a terrible context. A context where you can look back at the bombings of 2008, 2014, when you look back at the levelling of houses, the shooting of Shireen Abu Akleh, and 200 others in the incidents around the Great March of Return. For those who say war must continue until Hamas is erased, do you really believe that's possible and at what cost? You don't remove an idea that leads to organisations. It could reappear under any number of different guises. You actually achieve peace by removing the grievance at the very basis of this conflict. At some point, you have to talk about those grievances. Peace is not negotiated by jolly good friends sipping tea in the Rose Garden and agreeing to be nice to each other, if only history was that civilized. Peace is squeezed like blood from a stone out of the resisting paws of bitter enemies. The international community has abdicated its responsibility to encourage a peace process in the Middle East for years, for decades. That has to change. I call on every elected member to be committed to peace because of the colossal scale of suffering, the horror that occurred on October the 7th, the horror that ensued with the death of 12, 13,000 people under the bombs. And I'll tell you what, violence is as ugly if it's committed by a knife or an AK-47 as if it is bombs 500 kilograms busting through the earth on the innocents below. Violence is violence. So we're calling for a humanitarian ceasefire as a precondition for a peace process, because this has got to be solved. Give peace a chance.
While they think it remained on the trigger of the assault rifles they carried at all times. the soldiers were. They looked years younger than me, and I was only 20 years old at the time. One of my lasting memories is when we visited a group of Palestinian children who dressed in tartan kilts and gave us a musical rendition of the bagpipes. I have often wondered what happened to those children. When we were leaving, our hosts asked that we not forget them, and we do what we can when we are back in Britain to help bring peace and justice to Palestine. It is my personal shame that I have not done enough, but it is also to our collective shame that Britain has not done enough either. The events of October 7th were abhorrent and inexcusable, but despite decades of Israel's military operations to eliminate Hamas and the death and destruction that has rolled on both sides, Hamas remain as strong as ever. As Ami Ayalon, the former head of Israeli Security Service, Shabak, said, Palestinian terror can only be defeated by creating Palestinian hope. But there can be no hope for Palestine as bombs rain down on their children while the British government watches on in silence. Like many colleagues, I want a lasting and just peace for both Palestinians and Israelis. Hopefully today's announcement is the first step to securing a full and permanent ceasefire that is so desperately needed. So my vote today is for peace. My vote is for hope, and my vote is for lasting ceasefire.
So, as I said, I was hopeful we would avoid some of that tonight, because thankfully we all came together as political groups and we agreed on an amendment. And I'm proud of that amendment, you know. I think the best bit for me, which I'd like to just read, is Liverpool City Council declares that anti-Semitism, Islamophobia and all other forms of racism will not be tolerated in our city, and rejects any and all inflammatory rhetoric intimidation of communities affected by the situation in Israel Gaza. Council resolves to continue to work with and support all of our faith and community groups, such as the All Liverpool Initiative. Perfect. That's all we needed to say. It's not for us, as mere city councillors of Liverpool, to pass comments on military conflict. I didn't realise so many were experts. And I'll just finish with this. Sudan, South Sudan, Mali, Myanmar, Nigeria, Afghanistan, Syria, Iraq, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Yemen, Georgia, the Democratic Republic of Congo, Ukraine, Somalia, Western Sahara, Niger, Chad, Cameroon, Ethiopia, Burkina Faso, and Mozambique. Can I ask the movers, Councillor Radford, of the original motion, why they have ignored these 20 or so other conflicts, many caused by terrorist insurgency, which are costing thousands of lives each year? I feel the original motion is, in my personal opinion, unconstitutional. I fear it was anti-Semitic and therefore unlawful. I'll just finish by saying, I've already said,
the duplicity of the United Kingdom government in promising both communities the land that is now being fought over sowed the seeds of the destruction and devastation and conflict. We do have a heavy responsibility in the United Kingdom. I say that as someone who's proud to be British, but that doesn't mean we haven't made serious mistakes. And our duplicity was a serious mistake. Can I also say, I think a lot of this debate and our inability of the United Kingdom as a country to deal fairly and long term with the Palestine issue has been our collective guilt. Our collective guilt is, particularly in the United Kingdom and across the West, we feel guilty, and we should do, that we turned millions of potential refugees who were suffering under Nazi persecution in Europe. But our guilt for not doing more to support those people should not be the reason we are deaf to the needs of the Palestinian community.
I now put this to the vote. Could I see those in favour of the motion as circulated? And I think that's unanimous. Thank you very much for that. I did say at the beginning, I hope this would be in the best traditions of Liverpool debate, working together. I must say that I personally think this debate is handled very well by all members who spoke and those who listened respectfully to. Can we move back then to item 5, councillor questions? Starting with, if I remember rightly, Labour questions. Johansson is obviously going to speak.
Should be a Eurovision in the history of the competition. Not my words, those are the words of the European Broadcasting Union. I think when you look at all of that valuation, the very positive elements that come from that, and actually the impact on our young people is one of those important things. If I was to single out, for example, the Euro Learn programme we did as part of it, 17,000 school children here in Liverpool were part of that programme, inspiring the next generation of talent and performing arts, but understanding what we all have friends across Europe and beyond. Equally, when you look at the visitor economy, you look at the exceptional feedback we have from international visitors, you have 98% of people would recommend Liverpool for safe night out from those kind of international visitors, and this has been a huge opportunity. Another example of Liverpool being firmly on the global stage, showing exactly what we can deliver, and I'm very confident it will generate other significant events and other significant visits within this region.
I have the same views on the position there, once again while I'm sitting here, saying there have been two other very important events here that people have tended to forget. That at Liverpool Pride, it was led by people from Keane who couldn't save the assembly, and we should be proud of that. And I was very surprised when there was no publicity at all for the National Symphony Orchestra of Ukraine, who came to play at the Liverpool Philharmonic on one of their tours. So I have discussed that with Gamua Mankavati about how we use such opportunities as well as part of our diplomatic. If that's all right with you, thank you. We now move to Councillor.
Thank you, my Deputy Lord Mayor. Thank you for your written response for the Leader of Council. I had asked about the number of potholes that have been reported in the Council, and you noted that 4,380 have been reported from November 2022 to November 2023. Do you know that there will be duplicates within that and people contacting me about the same pothole? Actually, there will be duplicates in there about potholes that have been fixed and then fixed and refixed. I know Robertson Road in Mossley Hill and Hare Road and Speed, the same potholes are constantly being filled and filled and filled. And that is, you know, a sign of madness, where you're doing the same thing over again and expecting something different. The government has announced this week that it's investing money in potholes, and they say that the Lib Dem are going to not have a leaflet to be able to write.
Councillor Gallus, the bell, this is supposed to be a question, not a formal one.
Thank you very much. I'll back up to a question. I'm sure that the Leader of the Council will be happy to know that the Lib Dem leaflets will be changing because we won't have a pothole. Are you going to be committed that we're going to take that money and make sure that it's spent? And if 4,000 potholes have been reported, how come we have waited months, if not years, to get the same pothole fixed?
I think certainly addressing the problem. If that money is forthcoming, and I'm very, very wary of Tory snake oil salesmen, what the point is that, because they're trying to suggest that money released from HS2 will be filling these potholes. I very much doubt that, you know, because that money's already been committed on numerous occasions. Equally as well, this is an issue that needs addressing at a national level, because much of the funding to address this comes through highways management funding and integrated transport block funding, of which cities like Liverpool do not get the amount of money that's required for the number of vehicle movements that go over and across our. So there is a national issue that needs to. If the money appears, we will definitely spend it for political use. But I'm extremely sceptical that that money will appear. You only need to listen to Jeremy Hunt's autumn statement today with the fact that the plight of councils and local authorities is completely and utterly missed. Two words he did not say were councils or children, for example. Two of the most significant issues regarding this city and every other.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor, and thank you to the initial question. Can I just ask that if the council has spent over £500,000 since 2020 on repairs and maintenance,
very much, Lord Mayor. Certainly getting your breakdown list of how that money has been committed. Whenever I've seen reports of those things, I've asked officers to actually investigate that appropriately. Equally though, and as you both know, we do see the dialogue with the trainers, so we can actually address the issue of the outstanding arrears, because that is part of the process of how we address the long-standing issues with St John's and its sustainability and viability as a location as well.
Councillor Lent. Okay. Councillor Radford. Yes, Councillor Gilbert. You're here.
Yeah, the two questions. On the glyphosate, there isn't actually anything that says what step forward we can take. So I'd just like to ask if there's room to actually have a discussion at SILEP committee to go through possible alternatives. Particularly, the other element to this is we do have a massive problem with one particular weed, and that is Rumblea, that's bringing down walls over the city. And I think we actually need an action plan for this because it's causing a lot of misery for residents. On the sports centres, I do think after 13 years there are opportunities to invest in our sports centres, and I find it very unfortunate that we've ended up in this position with two of the sports centres, and I find it contradictory on the issue of, you know, public sector control. I'd just like to get a further comment from you on that.
Thanks very much, Alan. I'm going to be quiet to say it's not for me to discuss it, but I'm sure the chair of the select committee would be amenable to that and take that thought with you. In terms of a monthly action plan, that is very much something that is being looked at, not just by the select committee, but also the cabinet as well. Because you are absolutely right, it's an issue that can be significant in this city, but also in similar areas, particularly where we've got high proportion of tenant properties, as most cities have. In terms of the elements with regard to our approach to public ownership, I think from our perspective we've always been extremely pragmatic about the right way of doing that, but I'm very proud we're taking the steps to begin insourcing LSSL and the street cleaning and the refuse collection function. Very proud that last night at Cabinet we took the decision to bring the fact that statutory services school improvement Liverpool back into council board. Much like at city region level, we're going through that process of bringing parts of our railway back into the country. So always pragmatic around the line. On the issue of the sports centres, I think that's why we're looking at the different models to maintain their operation. At the end of the day, I appreciate you saying you believe we've had the opportunity to invest in those centres. The biggest difficulty, and I know we agree on this point, is the fact that the government has taken away almost 60% of our funding as a local authority since 2010. There are so many issues in the city that actually we would love to rectify, we would love to address, but we are held back by a funding formula from national government that does not recognise showed that if we don't keep global temperature increases below a 2 degree increase, by 2050, the flood risk for our city, as a river city, for our region, as a coastal city region, is absolutely huge. Our pierhead, our waterfront, our most recognisable physical asset would be a huge flood risk. Parts of the city centre are flood risk. Parts of the south of the city, significant flood risk. If you look at those maps, some of our neighbouring areas, large parts of Sefton, the north of the Wirral, you know, large parts of Hayward Wood are a huge flood risk. The merge of the breakers back as far inland as we can get. This is huge. These are our family, our friends, you know, other residents who potentially would have to move house if we don't address this issue. So from my perspective, it's absolutely vital as a planet we come together to address this. And as a city, we make sure that we do everything we can to address this. Now I'm proud of the fact that we've got a commitment to city council to be net zero by 2030, and as a region to be net zero by 2050. And there are some significant steps we've already made, particularly at the regional level, particularly with transport. I mentioned about the process of washery regulation, the zero emission fleet of its half, capped fares, the brand new fleet of trains that we're in the process of issuing. So these things are trying, but whilst comes with not without some hiccups, if you look at per usage, has not just been one of the most successful in this country, it's been one of the most successful anywhere in Europe. If you think about the 300 electrical vehicle charging points we've rolled out, the most in the city, as many as most citizens from this country, with an ambition to go much further. And if you look at our commitment to biodiversity, I know sometimes slightly controversial that we say all this, I'm certain with Chris Patrick we're doing the right thing. But I'm not going to sit here complacently. I know there's huge amounts that we've still got to do. And I'm particularly horrified by the fact we've got a Tory government who thinks it's a disposable policy choice. Thinks that at the end of the day we can somehow delay this, we can put it off to another day. We can't at the end of the day. Those commitments can't be rolled back. But one of the reasons I've opened this motion is I think the most important people in this process, actually our residents, our citizens, the people of Liverpool. Because at the end of the day, addressing climate emergency will require difficult and tough choices, compromises, trade-offs. And I trust the people of this city to get that right, to inform us and actually kind of make sure that we can take the really good, evidence-based, hard-headed decisions. And that's why I want to bring forward a Liverpool Citizens Climate Emergency Jury. A representative sample of citizens, not picked by us, not partisan stewards. Genuine representative of the people of the city. So we can go through that in a deep dive of the challenge we face, but also
to speak on the item as a whole. So we start off with the first amendment by Councillor Crone.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor, and apologies, colleagues, for being absent when I was supposed to be moving this in the first place. First of all, I'd like to welcome the fact that the Leader has chosen the subject of net zero for motion, and particularly the inclusion of an element of liberty and democracy in the process, something I've been calling for since 2017. However, it is worth noting that this motion comes some 4 years after the declaration of the climate emergency in the city. So in an ideal world, we would be beyond the stage of deliberation and well into the phase of serious action. And I'm afraid today, some of the actions that are listed in this motion are somewhat underwhelming. For example, the installation of the largest number of electric charging points in the Liverpool City region. Of course, we'd expect that to be twice as clean as any of the other local authorities in the region. The rollout of the e-scooter trial, allowing a private company to do something within our city. The program of implementation of cycling infrastructure in the city centre. There's a couple of new cycleways which are decent, and yes, they are to be commended, but a lot of the city centre does remain perilous to cycle through. And in most cases, it's impossible to get here safely because the roads leading here are still not benefiting from segregated cycle lanes. Some of the working buses, yeah, I have to commend that. I have to also emphasise the comments about biodiversity, Scouse Flower House, their fantastic project, over the really interesting piece of work. But the new Southern Grafton Park, and that's going to take years to be as beneficial to nature as the land that was already there before it was used as a dumping ground for waste from the Festival Gardens and Development Zone. So, at the moment, that's a net legacy. It will take a long time for that to be biodiversity gained. So, anyway, that I think makes it clear that a much larger effort, a much bigger push is required on a net zero plan. And that's why my amendment is to just change the citizen's jury for a citizen's assembly. Typically, a jury is up to about 30 people. An assembly includes between 50 and 160 people, a much larger number of people, a wider range of experiences and backgrounds. And they'll be able to analyse more information. Thank you there. Now, that's the best way to generate public support, and that's the best way to generate really good, positive recommendations from the members of the public who have chosen. There have been really positive examples of citizens' assemblies, for example, in 2016. Irish Citizens Assembly, which contributed towards the vote to legalise abortion in that country. So to be successful in the past, it's so important to get our net zero plan right. Let's do it. Let's do the gold standard. Let's have citizens' assemblies, and let's get the best possible result. Thank you.
To the second amendment being moved by Councillor Lake.